Previously, we examined the differences between the explosions of Units 1 and 3, and inferred therefrom a likelihood that one was a hydrogen and the other a nuclear explosion. That inference rested on the assumption, given identical buildings, structurally different explosions imply different explosives. However, it turns out that assumption is undermined by the fact that the exterior walls of Units 1 and 3 were significantly different. In this video, we'll examine these differences and how they might support both hydrogen and nuclear explosion theories. The upper deck walls of the nuclear reactor at Oyster Creek in New Jersey are of a lighter construction, with cross-lattice girders. Fukushima Daiichi Unit 1 has both the same reactor model, and as we can see here, Unit 1's upper deck walls were also supported by cross-lattice girders. A distinctive feature of Unit 1's upper deck wall structure is that two light horizontal girders run around the upper deck section. In contrast, here we see Unit 4, which has only one horizontal girder across the same upper deck region, and its girder is heavy and concrete encased. And here we can see that both Units 4 and 3 have the exact same infrastructure. Their entire walls, from bottom to top, were solid steel rebar reinforced concrete, unlike the relatively light and flimsy upper deck structure of Unit 1. From this evidence, we must conclude that Unit 1 had weaker upper deck walls, and Unit 3 had stronger upper deck walls. This then raises an obvious question. Did the weaker walls of Unit 1 allow lateral force projection, while the stronger walls of Unit 3 forced an upward projection? From this question, we can formulate Theory 1. Here we have Units 1 and 3 with their different structured upper decks, wherein hydrogen would collect from spent fuel pools accessed on the upper deck. Then a hydrogen explosion occurs in each. However, because the upper deck walls of Unit 1 are weaker, the force of the explosion blasts straight through the walls, projecting laterally. On the other hand, the walls of Unit 3, being much stronger, divert the shockwave vertically, shown here shooting straight upwards. Theory 1 has several things going for it. It looks like it might explain observations. And in positing fewer entities, Theory 1 looks like it could satisfy Occam's razor. But Occam's razor also requires that all observations be explained. And according to nuclear engineer Arne Gundersen, the explosion of Unit 1 was a deflagration, whereas the explosion of Unit 3 was a detonation, distinctly different species of explosion. And so according to Gundersen, Theory 1 isn't even a contender, at least if we assume only hydrogen was involved.
So the question is, what caused the detonation? A hydrogen-oxygen reaction alone won't do it. There has to be something more here. And the jury is still out on why, but a plausible reason is that a hydrogen reaction started, which then caused a shockwave to move and distort the nuclear fuel in the pool. The distortion of the nuclear fuel in the pool creates a prompt nuclear reaction, which then blows the rubble out of the pool, up in the plume, and creates the energy needed to create the dramatic event that we've seen at Fukushima Unit 3.
Considering the differences we've observed between the walls of Units 1 and 3 and Gundersen's causal thesis, a question arises. Did the stronger walls of Unit 3 reflect a hydrogen blast shockwave back inwards and onto exposed fuel, pressurizing it into a supercritical detonation? This question then undergirds Theory 2. Here we have Unit 3. The fuel pools were accessed from the upper deck, and here the water is so low that spent fuel rods are exposed to the air producing hydrogen gas. As the shockwave projects outward, it encounters the stronger walls of Unit 3 and is reflected back in and onto the exposed fuel. The instantaneously massive pressure on the nuclear fuel then triggers a supercritical detonation of nuclear energy that blasts upwards from the pool through the roof. That this could happen at a nuclear power plant has been a concern for scientists for some time. So the possibility is not a new idea. Moreover, recently published empirical evidence backed by mathematical analyses suggests that the Chernobyl accident was driven at least in part by a nuclear detonation, not purely by a hydrogen explosion as had been assumed. So Gunderson's causal thesis, and thus theory 2, appear to be well grounded.